Finance Committee to order. The Board of Selectmen already called to order.
You already returned to open session.
Okay, we're all in order. Very good. Good to be in order. Oh, sorry, and Ann Landry, Ann Johnson is joining us. Sorry, Ann Landry Johnson? Ann, how do I do it the right way?
Ann.
Ann Johnson Landry.
Ann Johnson Landry, thank you. Ann Johnson Landry joining by phone, which means that this evening, votes will be done by roll call. And Bob had a very good suggestion, I think, wherein we will have, when we get to, actually, any of the items to vote on, I think what we can do is have the, we can have a motion to bring them for a vote. We'll open them for discussion one item at a time. We will have discussion on the item. We'll move on to the next item if we can. And then we'll vote on kind of the package at that time. If we can do that, we'll see how that goes. All right. So what I think we want to do is go through the warrant, and then we'll get to the budget when it's time to get to the budget in the warrant.
Ann, especially if you can't hear me, just you know, and I'm sorry for shouting, but you guys have seen this warrant for a couple weeks now. I sent out an email today. There's only one change, snow and ice. So Article 4 is to revise the capital plan. Most of it was rearranging capital to fit in the high school litigation debt in the out years. I'll go over especially though the FY17 changes, since those are immediate. As many of you know, we canceled the Killam Field rehab. That was $350,000 sometime last fall. Facilities is asking for three different items totaling about $100,000, actually exactly $100,000. Some tile work at Joshua Eaton, water leak underneath, which they found very fortunately early on, or would have really been a problem. And then a couple of small masonry projects. And the selectmen, we're undergoing some rehab work to our water tower up near the high school, actually. And we had been planning to paint it. It's been in the works maybe for 3 years as a planning stage. We finally got to a price where it made sense to look at buying a new water tank as opposed to painting the old one and looking at the break evens and so forth. Our reason for speed was that we have antennas up on the current water tower, and we have licenses, and one expires next fall. So as part of this, believe it or not, all the carriers have been in this room and behaved themselves and negotiated with us very effectively. They change jobs all the time, so the guys that negotiate are really good. But the selectmen want to study the idea, and I do too, of designing a separate tower for all the antennas so that every time we need maintenance on the water tower, we don't have to go through this process, which is very expensive. And it ultimately reduces our lease payments because they have this expense. So if we build our own tower and have them put on it, Bedford has just done this, and it's much more lucrative. So we can make a couple of capital investments and yield some revenue from it. This is far from a done deal. We've talked to the neighbors. The neighbors that I've heard from are encouraged. They're actually not opposed to this because the equipment will actually move a little higher away from their houses. But this is obviously a community event that we have to discuss widely. But until we do a design, we just don't have enough to discuss. So we need $100,000 to do the initial design work. And I can't remember, somewhere in the writing of what the estimate would be, it's another $300,000 to build it or so. And again, we'll make that back quite handily in cash flow. And that's a future negotiation.
We can't convince them to go in and build a tower?
They would be glad to build it. I'd rather have the annual revenue, honestly.
Oh, because that would be in lieu of?
Yeah.
Yeah, agreed.
If there's any other questions, you know, feel free to stop me.
Do we know what the estimated annual revenue would be from the tower?
You know, that's a negotiations issue, and I'll say, even if I knew, I couldn't tell you, but I don't know. We're not making very much now. When we last negotiated this years ago, the prices were lower. They're better now, so we're going to improve the revenue one way or the other. If we take this cost away from them, they were going to be paying $400,000 or $500,000 to move their equipment. We do this instead, they will just move their equipment onto a permanent structure and it'll cost them almost nothing. So we will have $400,000 to $500,000 of their money to start out with, to play with, to spread over some of these, plus whatever else the market price is. So, you know, if it brings in another $50,000 to $100,000 a year, that's probably ballpark what it is. It's not astonishing amount of money. There's also a request in FY '17, in both water and sewer, I'm sorry, sewer. We need to add on to a project that's already underway. We don't think we'll need 200,000, we think we need 100,000, but it seems much more sensible to have enough. They ran into some groundwater problems in one of the sewer stations they didn't expect. So I don't know if there's any other questions on capital. It's been out there for a while. I'll continue to go through all the financial articles, Mark, and you tell me when you want to stop, if at all.
Okay, let's, just for one second, any questions so far? Okay, I'm derelict of one of my duties. Tonight's meeting of the Finance Committee is being recorded for RCTV Live, Comcast Channel 22, Verizon Channel 33. Videographer for tonight's meeting is Steve. Sorry about that, Steve.
And the next article is revisions to the current fiscal year 17 budget. You can see the capital expenses in C99 I just described. We have a surplus in health insurance premiums, which is good. And I mentioned to you previously a couple weeks ago about the retirement assessment being too high this year and went down. Actually, it didn't go up as much. There's also been less enrollment in the vocational schools. I did just get an invoice yesterday, which surprised me. I don't know why vocational schools can't count students in the building, but they don't seem to be very good at it. Our enrollment went from 16 to 18 in the Wakefield School, and as of January, they said it was still 16, but the kids have been there since September, so I don't know. So that may be a November request, because the budget might be 20 or 25 grand out of balance. Under all the departments, there's a couple things. There's vacation, sick buyback. Later on, I'll describe that we're eliminating that fund. There's also paying class funding, and in this department, this is where the money is, so it's all moving out. Some of it, if you will, moves back in for this department. It moves to many other departments. That's all budget neutral. The actual money that's being spent, if you will, is some extra technology over time. We had that extra election for the override in October, and it's going to cost us $4,000. We have saved some funds by one position not being used as much as it might have been. So generally, that's all self-contained and self-paid for. For town council, I'm asking for $50,000 for town council, $30,000 for special TLT council, and $25,000 for cable council. $25,000 of the town council number is TLT. That's a good number. I don't think he's fully billed us, but it's pretty close. The special council for TLT, I just never know, honestly. Invoices sometimes appear, so I think this is safer. We can't. In that line, we can't do anything other than spend it on lawyers, so it goes back to free cash, we don't need it. One of the things I did bump next year is town council's budget, because there's a variety of things upcoming. And then the special council cable is nothing to do with that tower I just described, but Matt Cornelis, who's also a lawyer, is in charge of the town side of helping negotiate a deal with all of our two cable providers. So those licenses are up in 2 years. It's a two, three-year process. It's a very specialized field, and Meyerson and Harrington preferred not to do it. They said there's better attorneys out there to do it. So that's a request which will then carry us forward for a couple of years, we hope. We have promotions process. We need almost 10,000 in that. Let's see. We're saving some money in Gene's department. We had funded some building inspection positions a little higher than we needed to. We funded an economic development director for a full year, but it has not been necessary. The community services director was, you know, we left, this John Fito left for the Y in the fall. We didn't fill the job, and we've eliminated the job. That's how much money was left over from that. So this department's providing almost $100,000, you know, for the rest of the budgets. We are giving poor Andrew a few thousand dollars for economic development expenses. Finance department, there's really not much going on. And a couple of retirements. Public safety, there's a lot of things going on, and I apologize, I never really followed up with you other than to send an email for Paula's question, especially on public safety wages. I hope that answer was helpful. For the past couple of years, it's worked out fine. For this current year, it's not going to work out fine. There is going to be a shortfall, and this is where it is. So specifically, this $40,000 line, we are going to be short probably by $40,000 if we don't do something. Some of these other things, again, there's five retirements there. There's 140 grand. It's not a small number. These are generally the things that have been eliminated in the contract going forward. They go away, but there's still a handful of employees out there. there's some requests. If your town meeting didn't fund them, then we just wouldn't continue. But, you know, typically, the state is backing away from paying for a lot of things continuously. They didn't let us know until January. I guess they had done it in October. They didn't tell us till January that they don't fund annual CPR training for police anymore. That's a requirement under law. We have to do it, so now we have to pay. That one's not optional. The next one is optional. $7,000, the fire department would like to do active shooter training. I kind of assume they don't have the guns in that scenario, but I wasn't exactly sure.
So do we have that CPR training in the budget going forward?
Yes. It's implicitly now part of the overtime budget, which is why one of the reasons I bumped it up so much. I can't remember, 25 to 30,000. Let's see, expenses, there's a couple. We have not yet regionalized animal control. We are talking to one of our neighbors. The other one we thought we were all set with backed away. They're providing 50,000 to pay for a couple of things here. The fuel budget is, you know, showing a good surplus this year, and I did cut it for next year. We did, somewhat unexpectedly though, we've been running a pretty high outsourced repair bill, and there's no one reason for it. It's a number of different pieces of equipment. But in the old days, you know, FinCom, this used to be an annual event of 100,000 or more. It's nice that we haven't had this discussion in about 6 or 7 years, but you know, it is needed for this year. I sent you an email today. I think it's smart to request 250,000 as of tonight. We might amend that on the floor town meeting. Hopefully the snow is done by then. If it doesn't snow, that number is too high, but for now it, you know, seems reasonable to leave it alone. Library, not too much going on. Again, one departure, and they're using some of the pay in class money. Facilities, again, one departure. This one here, Sharon's here if you need an explanation, but earlier in the budget process, by mistake, I deleted the entire school budget with one stroke of the key, and Sharon did a similar thing to this journal entry. Mine was worth a lot more than this, though. We had an encumbrance from last year for $125,000. She closed it out. All it means is $125,000 now goes to free cash this year, and now it comes right back out. If she hadn't done anything, no one would have noticed. So it's the same net effect. And this is because at a past town meeting, we changed $125,000 to be an expense, to be capital instead of an expense, so it really is just accounting. Earlier tonight, the school committee in open session did a vote to ask for this $150,000 part two of the science curriculum. On balance, we're $260,000 to the short, but we are suggesting to reduce $60,000 of the permits revolving fund, inspections revolving fund, because we cut back the economic development director. We didn't have him all year, so that's just a match. So you have to basically use up the rest of the stabilization fund, such as it is, add another $60,000, which is no longer an offset, and you have $300,000 of free cash. And again, this is, if you want to look at it simply, pretty much everything's paying for itself except snow and ice, if you want to summarize it that way. $200,000 I mentioned for the groundwater issue is coming out of sewer reserves. They are extremely healthy sewer and groundwater reserves. So the selectmen, this is the only article that's changed since the selectmen voted, so I just noted it was $100,000 when they voted. Any questions on the current budget year?
Were you going to say more about the SIP buyback? I thought you, when you touched upon it, you already said.
Well,
How many employees would you say we have left?
I don't know. That's an interesting question. There's two parts. One is vacation, which technically everyone would have, which when anyone leaves, they have some amount of vacation leave. In almost every department we have, when someone does that, we have enough funds available to pay for it because there's a gap in hiring. That's not always the case. For instance, we have a DPW supervisor retiring in May, June, and we have already agreed to hire his replacement and do some overlap. So the extent he has vacation that we need to find the money for, we don't have it. So that's the kind of vacation money you'd see. The other stuff is eliminated in every union and all non-union. I don't know, there's probably 40 or 50 people left.
Oh, that many.
You can see the amounts vary.
Yeah, the amount's quite.
Police and fire are clearly the highest, but again, some of this is vacation. You know, shouldn't say this too loud, but three police officers cost the same as two firefighters. And then you get to finance. Two people cost less than $3,000.
Yeah, no, it's,
so
the
it's a big variable
and fire
number.
Notice.
And there are other examples in here where this thing happened that I don't feel like I need to show you because things balanced. And, you know, only really very unrelated things do I feel like I need to show a plus and a minus just for transparency. Again, if a position was empty and the person before left and we needed money, I don't feel the need to say that to anyone. It just pays for itself. When I did start mentioning 2 weeks ago when we said set up a stabilization fund, we had anticipated needing to put in $200,000 to $250,000 a year for several years to fund it. Where are we going to find that? So it just became pointless. So we just pay as you go.
Right,
because
it was relatively recently we set that fund up, right?
It's in an article. I can't remember.
No.
It's like 6 years, something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, okay. During my time.
Anything else on...
So the major change going on here from what was in the last published one is the change in snow and ice from 100 to 250.
Correct. Yeah, nothing else changed.
Any other questions? Let's roll on.
Article 6 is a late bill we found for $90.72. Goes back to June of 16. I don't really remember yet. It ended up in someone's junk mail filter. We just learned about it in January. And, you know, you have to pay a prior year's bill. It's kind of annoying when you find them and they haven't really chased you down. Because again, Sharon can close the year, what, as late as mid-August? If someone had billed us, we could have paid it, but such is life. Article 7 is a lot of equipment being declared as surplus. Most of it will be traded in. Some of it might be sold electronically. And actually, I got a question from DPW a week ago saying, if it's declared a surplus, can we keep it? And I was like, sure. And as long as you can afford to do whatever you wanted to do and you don't need a trade-in, yeah, if you want a backup. We did that for the senior center van. We bought a new one. We ended up getting a grant that paid 80% of it, so they kept the old one as a backup, and it's been really helpful. So just because it's declared a surplus does not necessarily mean it'll be disposed of, but almost everything on this list will be. Article 8 is the OPEB annual article, but it's a little different this year, and I need to write up. Reading got out a little ahead of the state law and set up OPEB funding, as did a handful of other communities. We now feel that we should adhere to the state laws that were since created and just make sure that our OPEB trust conforms to the state sort of rules, which didn't exist again. So part of this article is to make our trust funds conform. And then the other part, and the more traditional important part, is to move money. Just as a reminder, there's money put in all these budgets for this. They are, if you will, a cushion against health insurance premium inflation. If we get our guess, you know, we're guessing, say, 7.5%, comes in at 12, this is the first place I'd look for money to pay for that difference. And the last year we had, I don't know, an 8-something percent increase, but it was okay. We didn't need the money. So again, this is a really helpful thing for a lot of reasons to defease these liabilities and put this money in the trust. Our water, sewer, storm water, and light departments are on a pretty aggressive funding schedule. Our general fund can't afford that right now. It's really simple. I think, as a chairman, like $1.75 million, $2 million a year we'd need to do in the general fund. And we're doing 500,000, so we're falling behind, but we're doing the best we can. I don't think Article 9 is yours. That's another crack at open road. No, I did list it, so maybe. Sort of a rehash last fall. Article 15 discontinued portions of private way, and that was passed. Article 16 attempted to do two things. One was to accept the school committee and any other body's vote that the land was surplus, not they were not needed. And then to authorize the selectmen to sell or otherwise dispose of it. I didn't do a particularly good job of explaining this to town meeting when it was up for reconsideration. There wasn't really an opportunity to explain it. But this effectively just, this article only does this piece, which would have been the reconsideration, and it's paperwork. It's not giving the selectmen any permission to do anything. we don't do that, it's very difficult, almost impossible to get anyone interested in the land because it doesn't have clear title. So it really is hopefully just a paperwork exercise. I wasn't sure if you wanted to vote on that, so I left it there. In the past, all boards have approved it. This is the library project. I think this will be tabled. I said if this article is needed, the town manager or his successor will have a lot of explaining to do. We got 141,000 so far. We have not needed even half of that. You know, we are getting near the end of a project where a lot of subcontractors have not been paid or chasing us. We have to use the lawyers. I got a registered letter for $6,000 the other day and probably spent as much as that on legal bills defending ourselves. We're paying $1,500. So yeah, the end of a project is a little bit messy, but we'll figure it out. I don't see any reason we're going to need this article, and I would not suggest that you vote on it tonight. If needed, again, someone will have to explain on town meeting floor. Article 11 is to support debt in the capital plan for sewer. So there is a sewer station. It's almost $2.5 million next year that is necessary to be replaced. Article 12, Sharon explained to you 2 or 3 weeks ago. It's the retirement board's request to increase the benefit by $30 a month. Yeah, $360 a year. Article 13 is to get rid of the sick leave stabilization fund with $30 in it. And here's the answer. It was set up in 2009. So it was useful for a few years, but we just never had the money to fund it. I don't know if you do 14, I put it there. It's the annual Affordable Housing Trust Fund allocation plan. We have a little more money than I thought. This is all boilerplate. It's just something we do every year. The option not to have to do this every year is to adopt the state's model, and the past Board of Selectmen had no interest in doing that. Maybe we should revisit it again with another Board of Selectmen. Article 15 is municipal modernization at its finest. We had to create a bylaw last November for this, and that did not relieve us of the responsibility of needing to do this article every year. And all it does is set up the expenditure limits and who are the authorities and what are the allowable expenses. And this is an exact carbon copy of what it was a year ago. There's no changes. Sixteen is the budget. We'll come back to that. 17 is to allow borrowing under Chapter 90 for state aid for roads. We authorize the borrowing and then we don't do it, but that's an important step in accepting the money from the state. Permanent building committee, you don't need to worry about. I think the rest is zoning. I think that takes you through the end. Yep, that's all.
Bob, I have a question back to Article 10.
Yep.
On the library, the one that you're suggesting
yep.
might get tabled. If for some reason it didn't get tabled, then how would people weigh in on that article individually at town meeting?
If something happens between now and what's town meeting, like April 24th or something, if it's really a crisis, I'd probably have to call you into session. If it's a minor thing, although I'm not sure how that could happen, but you know, technically the floor town meeting, you could vote it. I don't want to jinx this, but it's hard to picture us needing this, unless it's something that literally none of us have thought of, because we're pretty good at thinking of all the bad things that can happen, and some of them have. We can't come up with a scenario by which that 141,000 gets spent, you know, but people come out of the woodwork, you just don't know. The problem we could run into is if the general contractor is not paying subcontractors and is going after us because we have deep pockets, then we might be in a little bit of a temporary pickle and have to litigate in order to get money. But there's been no indication of that. But that's the only thing I can even imagine. The work's done. They're down to just, 40 or 50 punch list items, I think. They had, several thousand a couple months ago. So it's going well.
And there's really no... you can't have a dollar figure because the dollar figure currently is zero.
Right.
So it's something we could really vote on.
It's an article that I can't recommend to you to take action on because I have nothing to tell you, quite honestly. So the selectmen just skipped over and didn't vote. I felt it was important to put it in there as a placeholder, because who knows?
Vanessa, you had a comment?
I was at the meeting for the Library Board of Trustees. They don't anticipate meeting, so that's all helpful.
Let's hope it's all correct. Any other questions on everything we've covered so far, other than Article 16, which is the budget?
I did have a question. This is Ann Landry. I had a question on Article 12. I remember that Sharon had said that passing this article would not affect the school to get towards full funding, but I was wondering if it would impact the town's annual contribution.
She's coming down.
Okay.
So the actuary built that change into our assessment amount already.
Okay.
So if you chose not to pass that, the money would just go to defease the liability sooner. It's already
okay.
Built in. Does that answer your question, or what's it?
It does.
Yeah.
It does. Thank you, Sharon.
Anyone else?
Well, one thing I want to clarify, when you said this, this is a $5 a month change for
okay.
the people who qualify, so it's a $60 a year change for each retiree who qualifies. But it becomes at a hefty price tag.
And you're saying that assumption was put
it's
into the liability?
It's already built in, so the town has already paid an assessment that already built it in. We were supposed to ask for it in November, and we tabled it because we were at a sticker shop by the cost. So the overall present value of what it really they still wanted to ask for it.
And Sharon, we had talked a little bit about kind of the presentation of that. Have you?
I'm not presenting it. The assistant chair is, so we're going to discuss it at our next meeting, which is next week. How to best present it. The other thing I wanted to point out is I handed you a PowerPoint that said 7.75% was our discount rate, and it was reduced to 7.65. So I think that she gave us like what the actual liability was at 7.75, which is what we were at the time when she was presenting, but we had changed our assumption down to 7.65%, which it's still $1.5 million present value change in the liability. But that actual sheet I handed out was what was in her packet and kind of changed because we changed our assumptions. So it doesn't change the material, but just worth noting.
So I guess, are there articles that we want to discuss? Any other topics we want to discuss within those articles so far? In other words, any kind of, we had quick discussion and questions. Are there any things we want to talk about before voting?
We could jump to Article 12, the one we were just talking about,
yeah. So
uptick in COLA.
You guys, I don't know if you remember, this is the one that we had the handout. Fire away, Paul.
And mostly my concern is timing. I think it's a really difficult year to take something like that on. I think as you roll it up through the years, it just becomes such a big number. And I just, although it's something I'd like to support maybe in future years, I'm concerned about doing it at this time.
Other thoughts, comments on this one? No. I tend to agree with you, Paula. I think that it may be a good idea, but I don't think this is the right time to do it. We're facing very, very difficult times, and I just don't think that there's extra kind of to be passing around right now. So I'm leaning against this one very strongly.
Mark, I am having some trouble hearing you.
Sorry.
I'll turn.
My comment basically was supporting Paula's comment that I'm not sure this is the right year for this to take place. The money is very tight. We're scrutinizing things very, very tightly, and I don't think this is the right time to do it. Any other comments on 12?
I agree.
Okay, Bob, your recommendation, should we vote these or should we try to get through the budget?
It sounds like you ought to vote on 12 as a standalone, and then if you choose, you can vote on all the other articles you mentioned except for 12 and except for the budget as group if you're all amenable. That way you only have two roll call votes to get up to the budget.
Sorry, everybody? Okay. So, just to be clear for a moment, on Article 5, can you show the amount of that again? Is that 323,069.32?
Yes.
323. Just want to get to it here. So, 5. Yeah, so the original is 173,069.
Yeah, just add 150.
Okay.
Part of my pack.
Yep, 323,069. Oh, so it'd be 22. I had 32. 22. Okay. So the question before us now is, can we lump together a single vote on 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, pull 10 off to the side for a minute, we'll pull 12 off to the side, so 11, 13, 14, 15, and 17. Are we comfortable voting them as a group, or do we want to break any others out?
Comfortable as a group.
Same.
It's all right? Okay, so can I have a motion?
So
the motion is to vote on Articles 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, 13, 14, 15, and 17.
Do we want to vote on 9? Is that the one?
No, 9 is Oakland Road. 10 is the one that we, is the library without a dollar amount. Is 9 the one you want to pull out, though? You're asking, do we want to vote on 9?
That's what I'm asking.
I think we should. I think we did before. And I think that the discussion was to move it to a point so that you can have a public discussion of what to do with it. Right now it's in limbo. I'd be comfortable voting on it. How do others feel?
Fine voting on it.
If we did in the past, we should.
Yeah, I mean, to me it's consistent. There's no financial impact right now, but there was one thought at the beginning, there will be one at the end.
Right.
To me, it's just a consistent approach.
Right. Okay. All right. Okay. One more tie on this. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, 13, 14, 15, 17.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. So I created a little cheat sheet to make sure I do this the right way. Okay. Paul. How do you vote? In favor? Or
in favor.
Mark?
In favor.
Peter?
In favor.
Eric?
In favor.
It says Mark next, but that's Vanessa.
In favor.
Cheat sheet didn't work. Paula?
In favor.
David?
In favor.
Ann?
In favor.
Mark? In favor. So we're unanimous 9-0 on these. 9-0-0.
Do you want to sign them now as well? Or?
Yes. So do we want to just kind of go down the row? Is that the easiest way to do that? Okay. Paul, do you want to do 4?
Sure.
Mark, you're 5.
Sure.
Peter, you're 6. Eric, you're 7.
Yep.
Vanessa, you're 8. Paula, you're 9. Let's see. David, you want to do 11? And you want to do 13? I'm happy to do 14.
Sure.
And then back around the corner. So, Paul back on to 15, and then on 17. Mark, can you take that one?
Absolutely.
Great. Okay, we're all assigned on those. Okay, let's go to Article 12, which is the COLA item. Any discussion? Further discussion on this one? Okay. Can we have a motion?
Motion to vote on Article 12.
Sorry. Doesn't say it here. And as written, do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Roll call.
Oh, I'm sorry, roll call. Sorry. All right, back to the cheat sheet. Paul.
Opposed.
Mark.
Opposed.
Peter.
Opposed.
Eric.
Opposed.
Vanessa.
Opposed.
Paula.
Opposed.
David.
Opposed.
Ann.
Opposed.
And Mark opposed, so we are 090 on that article. And we're agreeing that we're not voting on 10, is that correct? Okay. Article 16, the budget.
Do I, am I next in line for the...
Oh, yes, yes, you are, thank you.
not volunteering, but...
Yes, thank you. It was purely by luck of the draw.
I want to get in before the budget. So.
Uh-oh, you're up.
Sorry about that. Okay, let's talk to the budget. So question first, are there any updates to anything that's on our spending scorecard at this point? Or is this is the starting point for the budget? Okay, this is our starting point. So we've reviewed these in some depth over the last 3 weeks, and the one item that right now is substantially different from what's been proposed to us is the school department budget. And I guess from the vote that was taken tonight on the school department budget, the 150 for the science curriculum has now been removed from this budget because it's now
yes, you just
the
voted,
5th to 17th.
You just voted on that as part of that.
Okay, so that the number that you would now have going forward per this book is? Okay, so the actual, I just want to get the actual number so we have it for.
It's 4,739,661.
Yep, that's 150 less than what's in the book right now.
Excellent. Someone could double check that.
So on this one, maybe what we should do is the same approach. Let's look at which items we don't have discussion on, kind of lump those together, and then take the items that we do have discussion on and keep that separate. Does that make sense? Okay. Bob, do you happen to have the scorecard that you can put up on the board?
I'm not sure that I do. I can go get it, though. Just call. You want me to get it?
Does everyone have a copy of the scorecard with them?
I don't know.
Yeah, please.
Sorry.
Okay. We'll do a little song and dance or something.
Want me to make a copy of
it? Take it.
So maybe what we can do is talk a little bit about are there, well, you probably want to look at, let's look at the sheet first. Let's take a minute and do that. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So there are 26 items. And I assume you have a copy of the scorecard? Sorry.
Sorry, did you ask if I had a copy? I have a copy.
Great.
Mark.
Yes.
I have a revenue question before we get into this that I realize
sure.
I probably should have asked a couple minutes ago, but once Bob's back.
Okay. on the changes. The water enterprise fund and the sewer enterprise fund, they're slightly lower.
Okay, sorry. I was still doing the song and dance. So a couple of just quick items. Maybe if you can walk through changes from the previous version. So it looks like it's in W99 and X99. The numbers are just slightly lower than the previous version. Is there anything material there?
No, I mean, I don't even remember if there can't be material. The selectmen set rates a month or so ago within the last month. And I remember there were some last minute adjustments, but they were all minor. So I assume whatever difference you're seeing are pretty small.
Yeah, it's about $70,000 between them total.
What's that amount?
Out of 12 million.
We had one difference in retirement and one difference in insurance, but I wouldn't have thought it added up.
Yeah, it's mostly in the sewer budget.
That's debt service. It went down, right?
It went down, right?
Yeah, there's an MWRA interest-free loan, but I thought we had to make a certain payment next year, and it turns out that was delayed a year. That's the biggest reason, almost the entire reason.
Okay.
That was down 60-something thousand, but whatever total you're saying. And that number did get in time for the selectmen's vote.
Great. Okay. So if we look at the line items on the scorecard, I think that we want to take U99, the school department, off to the side. Are there questions on any of the other items on it? I want to have further discussion. So over last week and 2 weeks ago, we went through, 2 weeks ago and 3 weeks ago, we went through all these items. There aren't changes since that time. So are there any other questions, any other items you want to haul, put off to the side for a moment?
Mr. Chairman, may I suggest we hold J91?
J91.
And I'd like to hear the school presentation before we address that.
It's public safety wages. So that's public safety wages?
Yes, sir.
Any comment from the committee on that? What's the...
may want to move in front of the board and increasing that line item amount, but I want to hold my fire for now. Until I hear the school presentation.
So procedurally, just so I'm understanding it, if there's going to be a motion to change this, that comes from the Finance Committee, or can it come from the floor as well?
It's the Finance Committee's budget, so it needs to come from the Finance
Committee.
Right.
Okay.
Well, we can indicate our support. That's what we're really doing. Okay.
Yeah, it's practical to pull it out of the motion for everything if there's going to be discussion.
Okay.
Or alternatively, you could just indicate where discussion is needed, and when all that's completed and agreed to, you can make one motion for the whole budget. Lines this through that. You don't have to do the vote on the lines that are seem agreeable at first. You can mm-hmm. very end
just do it all at the end.
Yeah, that seems fine. Okay. Any other line items that are questionable at the moment? No? All good? Okay. So why don't we deal with U99? So here's where we are right now. There is the recommended budget that balances to the current revenues. That budget is 41,301,651. That's the one that's on the scorecard. We also have from the school committee. A different number, which would be 41,739,661. The difference being a request for $438,000.
And $10.
$438,010. Okay, thank you.
Here's
$10. Okay.
So everyone
counts.
Old numbers.
So here's kind of where we are, and I think what we should do is kind of allow kind of a full discussion through the committee. We're in a very tough budget situation. It's not a surprise to anyone here. We had a good discussion last week about what can happen, what's realistic. In my mind, there is a
only one long-term solution to what we're talking about, and that is that we either have to have an override that passes, or the town has to accept continually reducing services. There aren't any other positions that are available. I think what's under discussion is what can happen for this fiscal 18. A proposal was brought forward that would cut the eighth grade language program, and that's this $438,000. There's been a discussion to try to bring it back, to try to preserve it. And the question is there a funding mechanism for that to happen, either within the budget or beyond the budget? So that's kind of where we stand right now. I've been giving this a lot of thought. I know all of us have been giving this a lot of thought, trying to figure out how to accommodate all these things. My feeling is as follows. I think that we, as a finance committee, back in October or November of last year, suggested that we'd authorize up to $1.2 million in free cash to support the operating budget. The current operating budget, as we're looking at it, I believe only uses $1.1 million. My feeling is that the 1.2 is what we thought was appropriate. My feeling hasn't changed about that. I think that that's the right number to use. And I would suggest that that go to support the school budget, the full $100,000 for this year, for the specific purpose, in my mind, of supporting the language program activities. I find myself in a very tough spot in terms of what other sources of funds there are. I think that the town manager has made clear a lot of support for helping this. He's identified some holdbacks that, if needed, would be brought forward to town meeting. That would be somewhere around $132,000 or $136,000. So if...
How about $138,010?
Just to round it off.
I'm just talking around numbers here. No? So I think where I'm coming from at this point is that there are a need to be some opportunities that the school department needs to work through within their current budget to support this activity if that's what they want to do. I personally think that using that extra $100,000 of free cash to the 1.2 is the right use here. Very much appreciate the support the town manager is offering so that we can kind of all work together and find a solution to this. So my feeling is that I would suggest that 100K comes forward.
Yeah. I think building on that, right, the way I've looked at it, if we take the 438, similar feeling on the 100K brings us down to 338. Give me round numbers, right, what Bob has identified brings you closer to 200. We saw the slide from the school committee last week that historically showed a very consistent, return of funds at the end that was close to 100,000, right? There were some ups and downs, but it's a pretty consistent number. So we're down to 100,000. Mark, to your point, the only way this works in the long run is with an override. But we're not talking about the long run. We're talking very specifically about next year. I think we've heard, from the town clearly where they feel, where they stand on this. I think that Bob's, willingness to shift things around shows that, a different level of concern from the town citizens than we have heard on other things. So to me, we're really bridging 100,000. I thought 1.2 was the right number. I still feel that way. But this feels like if you're getting as close as 100,000, to me, with the risk of giving up specifically, while we're only voting a single line item, right, we all know what impact this has, on foreign language, the cost and the missed opportunity of taking this away and then ultimately bringing it back in, to me is short-sighted and doesn't make sense to the students. It doesn't make financial sense either, because again, the only way this works is with an override going forward, this and many other things. So without an override, we're facing several other challenges and not just this one. So I break it down into several different pieces, but personally, I'm in favor of supporting it. I think it's important. I think it needs to be done.
I'm sorry, supporting.
Sorry. I keep losing myself on the right way to say the 438. I guess I would have to say increasing. How do we present it and vote on it, Mike?
The budget as presented.
Yeah,
with
the 438. We'll figure out the wording, but I support the 438. I think everyone knows where I stand.
I agree with both of you. What both of you said. I don't think I very much to add. You guys covered a lot of the open issues, but overall, I think it would be the right thing to do to support the 438 to be included. I guess the third best.
So to clarify, you guys are suggesting that the number of the 41,739,661, not the 41,301 that's in the balance budget.
Yes.
I think I can also support the 41,739, but I'm not sure. I think I might disagree on how we pay for it. And that is, I think, well, for one, as has been said, without an override, next year is big trouble. And, you know, we can't afford to do this every year, but I think we have to do it this year. And I would actually feel that we should move an additional amount from free cash in order to cover that. And I mean, the school committee has to know that, you know, anything they can do to generate an extra couple hundred thousand free cash would be greatly appreciated. But I don't think we can go in and just, there is the possibility of April town meeting of giving the extra, or November town meeting of giving extra money, but I think for planning purposes, we do it now and, you know, just hope that we can get some back later. Because I think it's, I'd rather give it now, know where the budget stands, and hope that it comes back as free cash.
Can I come up? I agree with you overall. I just think, not that anyone wouldn't try to regenerate that cash, but not including it now may have just a little more incentive to kind of everyone sharpening their pencils. That's the only thing I'd add.
Yeah.
But overall, I think we're in the same place.
I think they've made a good effort with the budget as it stands. And like I said, if there's more to be saved, I think they would have put it there. So, again, I think both the money now is part of the main budget, and hope for the best. So,
let me use my chairman's privilege just for a second, if I could. One thing I probably should have talked about and didn't, that we started to talk about last time, was risk. What level of risk we're willing to assume here. So some of the comments have been, let's not assume much risk, let's basically put the money, set it aside now. One of the things that we've been doing with the budget pretty regularly, we do it with health insurance, and we do it with state aid, we do it with other things as well, is we decide on a certain amount of risk. And if things are different from what we expected, then we go, and that's the point at which we might go back and look at free cash. Explicitly, we've said that in the last couple of years for state aid and for health care. One of the things that we also talked about was there is a general regeneration of cash over the last several years, although not a guarantee, but definitely something that happens, it's been happening on a regular basis. And a lot of it is because I think we budget very conservatively. We've had some good luck. but there is this regeneration that's taking place. What I was going to suggest is that we should decide as a group also how much risk we're willing to take in this budget versus kind of saying, no, let's just not take the risk and take it all out of free cash now. As I think where I'm coming from is my belief is that taking that risk, taking some risk, and if it's the order of magnitude is only $100,000 or $200,000, that's very reasonable, and rather than take it out of free cash. So sorry for exerting privilege for a moment, but Eric, go ahead, I'm sorry.
I'm almost comfortable with it. If I just look at it very dispassionately, I completely understand where the school committee is coming from and in bringing forward the higher number. And I certainly sympathize with the idea of funding it now to free cash just to remove all that risk. It's people's jobs. So, but if I look at it completely dispassionately, the Finance Committee voted for the 1.2 in November. I actually voted against that. I was comfortable with the million, given what I'd heard. I've since become comfortable with the 1.2, so adding back the 1, because we've been down to the 1.1, makes a lot of sense. I'm concerned a little bit, and pardon me, it's my first time through all this, but as we set, you know, a number for free cash like we did in November, and then for this request to come for more, and for us to kind of, this is the wrong word, but acquiesce to that, is that setting a precedent in any way? And I don't know, maybe that's kind of been done before, and I'm not sure, and that's a concern. It's just a thought that I had as we kind of consider this. But as I grapple with that, I just wanted to put it on the table, but as I grapple with that, I'm getting more comfortable with the 438, but not comfortable with funding it out of free cash right now.
So is there kind of a position, so the 1.2 might be an avenue, and then how far toward the 438 are you thinking?
I guess,
how much of the 438 should go back into that number that then would have to come out of free cash?
I'd come out of free cash now. So I'm comfortable with the 100 because we're down to 1. And I'm comfortable with the holdbacks that the town manager's identified. I might draw the line there.
I appreciate the efforts that are being taken to save these positions and understand why these particular positions and the programs have been identified sort of for saving, if we will. And I want to stress that my concerns are based on not the programs or the positions specifically, but more the funds, where they're being identified for use. Essentially the source of those funds. We've gone through the numbers. What it amounts to from that 438 is 206. 138 from town holds, 100 from the 1.2 that hasn't been allocated yet. So that takes us to 200, even though that means that it would bring us up to 1.4 coming out of free cash. And due to some of the variables that we've discussed previously, as far as unknowns, and this goes to your point regarding how much risk we're going to take, we have no idea what that's going to be. And then ultimately how much may need to be used from free cash down the line. And my hesitation is that I feel like that's asking a lot of faith from town meeting because the amount of that need will be unknown. So coming at a time with the failed override and repeated discussions for transparency, I'm concerned that we're asking them to trust us with some unknown number. It's also coming at a time when we are down in our public safety. You know, we're down a firefighter, we're down a policeman, and we have no guarantee that this will be, that an override will pass coming down the line. So we're essentially saying that we are giving $438,000 and 10 when public safety is in a dangerous, in a precarious situation right now. And I, as was previously mentioned, I'm a little concerned about the precedent that it sets because we're just floating this forward. So. I realize that this is not a good situation. We need an override. Everybody's on board with that. From the school budget specific side, it's easy to sort of isolate that, but from a general town side, I feel feel like there are larger implications. So I'm not comfortable with the 438 at this point. But still open to other discussions.
I know we're all sitting here discussing how to apply Band-Aid, because that's all we're doing. And we're doing things differently than we would, because we know this is sort of a Band-Aid approach. I, too, am comfortable with increasing what we have in the budget now in terms of revenue to 1.2. That's originally what we set out to do. So that's, you know, 100,000 of the 438. I'm looking at this as taking then a $338,000 risk going toward to November. The town has already said we'll hold back to, you know, about 138.10, let's say.
Roughly.
So again, round numbers, we're talking about $200,000 risk we're taking. And I go forward saying, yes, we support holding on to the program the way it is with the middle school teachers, but we take it, you know, school sort of takes a $200,000 risk going into November. Because it's just difficult when, you know, you build any budget based on assumptions, and when 80% of a budget is salaries, and so much of that's going to get sorted out in the summer. So I'm comfortable taking the risk and seeing where we're at in November and doing what we need to, whether the town needs to transfer or not at that point, and what the school salaries look like based on, you know, summer hires and retirees and so on. So I support just increasing free cash by another 100,000, the 1.2 that we discussed.
David?
So while I'm still on the last, I can't help but be last, but I don't want to be repetitive or any good arguments and reasons why we should do and what we shouldn't do. But so I'll be short and brief, hopefully, here. One, I don't believe taking money from free cash is a sustainable growth, so I don't think, and nobody here says that. And I think you rightfully point out what's the risk, and when you look at the risk versus what we had ahead of us in terms of achieving for our community, for the best of our community, in my opinion, I think it's the right thing to do. But I acknowledge, like everybody has done, it's not sustainable. So if we don't get any help next year, then we'll have to come shoppers.
How far are you comfortable this year?
Just what we discussed.
So
1.2.
1.2.
Yeah.
Ann?
Hi. So I might propose a bit of a hybrid approach between taking the 438 out of free cash and the Cogent Path Forward. I was convinced by the argument, certainly, that taking away the middle school teachers would structurally change the way education is delivered through the high school level for years to come, and that if those positions were eliminated, there wouldn't be a way to restore them and restore the educational model with a quick fix should funds later become available. So that being said, we are looking for a one-time solution here. But one that really does underscore our need for an override. I appreciated Bob's creative thinking with the Cogent Path Forward, but we did hear from the schools last week that they didn't expect to be able to make up the difference by holding back on purchases in the amount of $438,000. So in terms of a hybrid approach, I was thinking of making up the difference out of free cash up front rather than postpone things until the end, but only in the amount of the difference between 438 and the amount that the town and schools together would expect to be able to save at this point on holding back on purchases. And I think we know it's about 132 on the town side, and I'm not sure what it is on the school side. And so that would bring us above the 1.2 million, but not in a great order of magnitude. And I think in terms of a one-time solution, it's certainly not ideal, but it is a solution, and I would feel more comfortable doing it up front, and I think it would be more transparent and more and based on kind of a reasonable expectation of the kinds of regeneration we would expect, or the kinds of money that would be saved, would actually be saved by holding back on purchases.
And I was going to jump in with something else first, but I just wanted to follow up quickly on what you said, and that certainly makes sense to me. You know, it does, I guess to your point, a hybrid approach. It gets us where we need to. It does have the transparency of saying, yes, there is an identified risk. We are going to fund it out of free cash. It also gives us a chance to highlight the fact that that identified risk is smaller because the town identified some things on their end. And I think that's an important part, having gone through this process for, maybe five years. I don't remember another scenario like this where something was, I mean, we have certainly been short of funds during each one of those years. This is different. This is the school coming with something that the town has said is so important that yes, we will forego something that we have planned that, you know, was certainly important to them. It made it on. They are short in areas. So to me, if one side is short to begin with and willing to give up some of theirs for, kind of, I'll say, the greater good, highlights the, you know, highlights the importance there. Sorry, just jotted a couple things down. The other thing I keep coming back to is, you know, our role is the Finance Committee. We're voting right now on the 2017 budget, but as a greater role, we're the Finance Committee. We're not the Finance Committee for 2017. And to me, on a $100 million budget, right, we start going down to a risk in the ballpark of $200,000. It's just, it's short-sighted for us to do anything else. It's going to cost us in the long run if we don't support this. It's going to cost us one way or the other. Is the schools, if the schools deteriorate and it doesn't happen, we all pay the price. We know the path that that goes down. If an override passes, if we don't do this and it doesn't become as dire, the schools don't deteriorate because an override passes, we still have to climb back uphill because we've cut. And not only have we cut and we have to replace, there are positions that will be cut. There's reputation involved there that, do we still get the same quality when we go to replace? Because I know if I were facing that situation as a potential employee to the town, that's something I would consider. How stable is this? How committed? So to me, when you look at the entire budget, one way or another, we have to figure out a way to get there. I think it's that important. I really like Ann's suggestion, but all cards on the table, I will find some way to vote to support it. But I do like that presented path.
So
can
I
Mr. Chair, the superintendent actually has a presentation that he wants
that
to
could give. Impact this discussion.
Okay, so I will address that momentarily. internal to the committee for another moment. One of the things that I think we have to also think through is brought up in a couple of the points are we setting precedents and how much of an issue or concern is that? Are there other needs that exist that may or may not, you know, be the approach this evening? To clarify my point, I'm not suggesting at all that we don't support and the school department go out and guarantee the positions. I'm saying that's exactly what they should do. The question is how much of it would be requested in the budget that goes to town meeting in April. And I think it's got to be enough so that everyone can feel comfortable that there's a way to get there. But I think that not all the cards have been played yet. And that we'll know better as the school year starts. We'll know better in November what it is. And there's a risk. And we'd have to be very clear with town meeting that there's a risk and that we, and when I say we, it's basically everybody in this room, would be coming back to town meeting with a request saying we did everything we could, and this is as far as we could get, and now we're requesting more funds. It's not a guarantee that it's going to go through by any means. But to me, I think it's a reasonable risk. So I'm happy to take that comment just one moment, but I wanted to just see if there's any other comment inside of FinCom for a moment, just on kind of where we are. I think what we would do after that is we would very much like to hear the presentation, see if there are other comments that come through, and then I think what we probably should do is accept a few motions with different numbers, talk those through, and then we'll vote from there. So any other FinCom comment first? Anne, anything from your side?
Nothing else from my side.
Okay, great.
I'll start. Our one takeaway from your last meeting last week was, I believe it was Ms. Landry's request, that we identify holdbacks on the school budget. And combined with that, also some salary savings that we've realized, the bulk of which I would say in the last six weeks.
Right.
There are a couple sizable ones that have literally, since we voted the budget, become apparent. So we've done that work, and it may impact this discussion, so we have some numbers to put to it. I don't want to ruin the punchline. We didn't solve the full $400,000 problem. But we made progress, and I think it might get us closer to a solution.
Great, please. Dr. Drew, yeah, come on.
So it obviously is the intent of the school committee, as you've heard several times, to find a way to keep those seven positions in the budget. And we've worked very closely with the town manager, Gail, myself, town manager, and town accountant, to try to figure out, you know, what's the best approach. And certainly the town manager holding back some purchases in FY18, $130,000 or so, is certainly going to contribute to this solution. What we've identified, assuming that we're looking at the 338 instead of the 438, and I know that's an assumption, that I'm just making that assumption for right now. As Ms. Borowski said, we have gotten a few more retirements in since we finished the budget process in January. If teachers don't qualify for sick leave buyback, they do not need to tell us a year in advance. So we do have a few more retirements from what we originally budgeted for. Plus we have two administrator turnovers. One is Joshua Eaton and one is the Rise Preschool. The Rise Preschool director announced her retirement Monday morning. So combination of those savings is $90,000. So that's one piece of this. The second piece of it that we have gone back and taken a good long look at, and it's not something that we want to do, but we feel that if we're able to find some savings in this fiscal year, that we can do some more pre-purchasing of materials and technology and cut an equal amount in FY18, which would be about $150,000. So you have the combination of $150,000 of your building-based budgets from the schools and technology, plus the $90,000 from the retirement and administrative turnover, plus the $100,000 from the 1.2 piece. That leaves a delta of about $98,000. Moving along with, you know, that the town manager is withholding $132,000, now we're in the ballpark. We're pretty much aligned. So, you know, that's something we can certainly do some things and wait until November. And then in November, we can see what's going on with our expenses and go from there.
John, can you just review that, the pre-purchase? Were you adding the 90 savings and pre-purchases?
Yeah, 90 plus 150, so that'd be 240, yes.
So the 240 there.
Plus the 100.
Right.
And it should leave 98,000, I believe.
So rather than the money from the town?
No.
That's what I'm going to follow.
Reduced?
No, including the...
No, that...
Start 330.
No. You would also take the money from the town.
That would be part of it in November.
Give us a little bit of push.
That would be part of it in November.
cushion is the wrong way because we're taking
right.
the
right.
But again, the assumption, right, as you said, the assumption is for November.
Yeah, it's a November assumption.
Right.
So that actually leaves, there's no, from my proposal, and I would say, I was proposing to fund the difference out of free cash, but there then would, in fact, be no difference. Except for, of course, for about 100,000.
Yes.
Yeah. Bob?
Yeah, just to be clear, so we don't undercount or double count, I think what John has said is 100,000 of free cash is the right answer.
Mm-hmm.
But keep in mind, the holdbacks on the town side are still voted as town budget for now.
Right.
So don't try to think that's matching, that's shifting over.
Right.
It may need to.
Mm-hmm.
If all of the numbers John just mentioned, I did it kind of fast. There's 130,000 of holdbacks plus 138,010. He needs 98. We're holding back too much. Nothing
right.
else changes.
Right. Okay.
But
that's what I was finding.
So the bottom line from his suggestion on the budget is 100,000 more. That's what's currently listed as U99.
Yes.
Start at the school budget and try to subtract.
Correct.
You'll never get there.
Right. Right.
Just start
right.
from a baseline.
So it'd be
yeah.
41,401,6.
Right.
661.
Make it
661. 661.
I know, it's really
bugging me. So I think if I could just add one other piece to this, is that this is I'm not saying anything that we haven't said before. It's an extremely tight budget. It's now even tighter. And I presented to you a lot of financial risks last week.
Yes.
Financial risks that do happen. And I know the town could come up with their own list of financial risks as well. We have some real concerns about how we're going to address those financial risks next year if they come to fruition. And you know, it is possible that we may be coming to town meeting for additional funds for some of those risks.
Understood.
Unexpected retirements, good news. We're going to save $30,000 with that. We've had a few more retirements. We're assuming no downsides news. We're assuming there isn't an unexpected, name it, long-term disability. A population boom and one bunch of kids move into one district over the summer and
right.
the class sizes get too high and we have to hire another teacher. We do typically they wash out and whatever remains, it's less than 1% of the budget gets set back to free cash. That won't happen this year. So it is going to under all but the best case scenario, this is going to impact free cash regeneration, you know, at the end of it. But I think John's point is really well taken. This is a completely different kind of approach than the school committee has taken, at least for the last 5 years. We pride ourselves on getting a budget and living within it, no matter what. And this is so tight and so aggressive, and it makes assumptions that are extremely financially optimistic. That the only way it makes sense is with the town manager's safety net, I'll call it, which has been said, but it should be said again, shows a tremendous amount of partnership and collaboration. But I do think we need to be clear with the finance committee about that and town meeting about that, that this is a risky approach from a sustainability standpoint. Oh, and a couple of the holdbacks that Dr. Doherty mentioned, particularly on the supply side, completely unsustainable.
Mm-hmm.
The technology and the portability. As Bob said in a slide in this meeting, this happens again next year, we do nothing. We cannot do this again. And technology is one I'll point to as a potential free cash ask in November. If we are finding that we literally don't have the computers to do the statewide assessments, we think we can eat by another year, but if we can, we actually need those computers and we will come and ask for however many tens of thousands of dollars to replace them. So just to be clear, this is
agreed.
No. It's
a higher risk.
Yeah.
A deeply aggressive attempt to make the numbers work.
So, a question, make sure I'm following. The pre-purchasing is essentially saying within the fiscal 17 budget to be able to.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we're hoping that, you know, we're doing our third quarter projections right now. We're hoping that if we have some savings, that we can apply it to that. What that also means, though,
yep.
is less free cash being returned
right.
at the end of FY17.
So. Right, so we're funding this a little bit by using
yeah.
regeneration that might have, that would have happened, and we're pulling it from there instead of from what's already in the account.
Yep. One more point, and I don't think I heard it me tonight, but Bob, you said this when you originally suggested this path forward. If we are able to make this work, granted you are, it sounds like FinCom is proposing an additional 100K of free cash, but this mitigates risk. Another risk is town meeting approval that is worth keeping in mind.
Yeah, to be very clear, the process from here is FinCom, we'll have a budget after this evening. That's our recommendation. We carry it forward to town meeting. We recommend that to town meeting. Then town meeting will question and we'll attempt to, you know, to have them approve it that way. And they certainly will have questions. I think our goal is to make sure that we have not just a cogent path forward, but a clear path forward in terms of what we present. It's very easy to understand. I'm sorry.
Not a sustainable path forward.
Not a sustainable path forward. A one-time opportunity to preserve the language program, being creative but not in an unreasonable fashion, and being, you know, I think we've been very conservative with our budgets and trying to kind of continue that path. So let me bring it back to FinCom after those comments. Any
quick question?
Sure.
What is there any new information since we talked last week besides the Rise preschool administrator retirement? Any other new information that led you to these numbers, or is it just more of a change in approach like you were talking about, Mr. Raskin?
When the school committee gave me guidance in November on how to develop the budget, one of the things that they talked about loud and clear was do not do any one-time gimmicks. I would consider the $150,000 piece of it, you know, an accounting gimmick that we're trying to make it work, you know, for one fiscal year. It's not something that I believe Ms. Borowski already said that we should be doing, you know, on a sustainable basis. We have had some retirements over the last several weeks from teachers announcing for next year that, you know, that we could apply to this.
Right, no, but none of that was new information. We knew all that as of when we spoke last week, except for the Rise preschool. I think you said gave her notice on Monday.
Yes, yes.
Monday, 2 days ago.
Yes.
Yeah, I think Dr. Darnley explained it well. Our guiding principle to him was we've always created a sustainable budget that we can stand by and look at and do that. And when we saw what the result was, and the community saw what the result was, there was a clear desire to protect the middle school positions. So the thought the school committee had was, we give you our sustainable, real, true, honest budget, and ask for $400,000 to cover those positions, because we can't cover them in our budget. And the reality is, I hope I'm being very clear, and I believe we are, we can't cover them within our budget in any way that we truly can. As Dr. Doherty said, there's 100,000 remaining that without the safety net at the town manager, I think it would be irresponsible to propose. But he is offering that safety net, and that allows us to take more risk than we normally would. So I would say what has changed is giving Finance Committee the option, if you choose to take it, of embracing a budget approach that is not sustainable and overly aggressive in assumptions.
That sounds great.
Let's do it. Does that make sense? Does that make sense?
Excuse me, 1 second. I've got Barry here.
Just a quick question for Dr. Daugherty. So, some of the savings that are proposed is for teachers that are retiring. So, yes. Is the savings that we're not replacing the teachers, or that we're replacing the teachers with younger teachers who are lower on the pay scale? Are we netting a loss of teachers?
It's not a loss of teachers. It's the delta from the teacher.
What you hire a new teacher.
Yeah, the teacher usually would be a top step.
Right.
You normally are not bringing in a teacher at top step to replace that teacher. It's an assumption, but that's a historic assumption. So
I just wanted to make sure that we weren't using FTEs on teachers.
No.
Thank you. So we don't know that for sure. Because we haven't replaced, we don't know that for sure.
No, we're not replacing that, but it's a historic assumption. It's a historic assumption that we're going with. We did not account for every retirement. We're taking what we think will be historic savings.
Chuck was next.
I think to your question, aside from the, you know, the one-time salary, the shift in cuts went from middle school teachers to the per pupil accounts.
Yes.
That's the primary difference. That's all it boils down to. I mean, the cuts are still there. They've just been shifted somewhere else.
So that per pupil was like 680 something.
Yeah, a total of 680,000. So a combination of the technology replacement line item and the building based budgets is going to account for the 150.
So the 680 will come down by?
I don't know the exact number, but it's a
technology.
Total 150 between the technology replacement line item and the building based budgets.
I was not, I got an update from the superintendent earlier in the day, and I was not at the meeting of the school committee prior, but the that building-based budget and the technology, you know, those were already seriously cut. We had to realign them. We did a ton of work on that, and we got pushback when we started talking about, well, we're going to cut the high school building-based budget so that we can fund what we need to do in the elementary, but that's going to mean that there's going to be some things that parents are going to have to pick up at the high school because we're not going to cover it, or perhaps the PTO will be able to raise funds. Perhaps they'll be as successful as the Library Foundation and raise some funds. So that, you know, that what we're doing here is saying we're going to try to find the money right this year in FY17 to cover that cut that we just committed to make that we weren't comfortable in the first place making, and we had a lot of consternation over. So, you know, it's been extremely difficult for us to go back and find any places at all. It's just, I don't want you to think that it was, we worked extremely hard on this budget to begin with, and to go back and keep trying to find these small hairs where we can pull something out. The only way that we can do this cut in FY18 is because we're saying we're going to try to mine the money out of FY17 and we're not going to be returning any free cash. I think there's been some confusion about the school committee's return of free cash, so I hope the finance committee isn't confused about it. But we have done that consistently to the tune of about 1% on average every year, with the exception of one year, which was much higher at 1.4%.
I think, obviously, whatever the decision that comes tonight, everyone is on needs to be on the same page, that we're looking for all the savings we can possibly find. You're in a position where a huge percentage of your budget lives in the wage line, obviously. But, you know, we all have to be very responsible about what's going forward here. We're in a really tough spot, and it seems that the town forces are willing to work together to make it work, and I think that's very admirable, I think that's very appropriate. But I think we need to continue to look, and there's not a time to stop and say enough. There's a time to kind of say, you know, what else can we find and where is it going to be? So I would certainly encourage that. Bob, did you have any commentary? You didn't have your hand up, but I just wanted to see if you had any.
No, I think you covered it all. Just wanted to make sure that you had the numbers right.
We'll get to that.
I have a question, though. So given these new numbers, thank you, by the way. I know this has been a painful process. And
we're not done yet.
I know. but given these new numbers, where does this leave us as far as where our risk is, right? I mean, we're looking at, I want to save these programs. We're shifting the risk a little bit. I'm trying to figure out which is more palatable from a town, if I'm, you know, as a, you know, for a sitting town meeting member. Is it easier to approve an expense down the line that's a little bit more concrete? Say we need to upgrade computers because otherwise we can't take state mandated testing, and that's something that we can point to right now and say this is the risk that we're facing. And I have to say I'm more comfortable with that approach because it's more substantial. Whereas with the sort of open-ended, a lot of unknowns, we may need some amount of funding in the future there's nothing to hold on to. The numbers are too open. I open that up to the others, but.
I think that's the risk discussion. To take zero risk probably is not a responsible position to take. To take infinite risk, obviously, is not either. The question is, where are we coming from?
I can answer that question. It's pretty simple. Taking the schools at face value for what they've said, they're not returning $150,000 of free cash this year. They're going to spend it. Okay. Effectively, we're giving them the $150,000 they might have otherwise had. It makes no difference for next year whether you give it to them this way or a different way. But it does impact year two, three, and four, because that $150,000 is not in their base. But again, I don't want to put words in the school committee's mouth, but I remember them saying the original request for 438 could just be a one-time request. We really need this for a year. So if that's true, this doesn't change anything. The remaining risk is the $98,000 that John could not find. And I have to tell you, that's covered by what we've done, if it needs to be. So there is no risk in FY18. The real risk is that people think, like, we've solved the problem, and you don't really need an override. Mm-hmm. That's the real remaining risk, and that has to be described very carefully by everyone.
I think there's two parts. I agree with you wholeheartedly, Bob. I think that people are going to perceive this as found money when it's not. And I think you guys have tried to make that clear, but obviously you'll
continue to try very hard to make that clear.
But I think there's, as you have the risk discussion, it's also a risk reward discussion. And I think that's getting left out. We're getting caught up in the numbers again. I think we've lost sight of the fact that what we're using the money for is super important. So just keep that in mind as we're thinking about this. Don't just think about the dollars and where they're all going to come from. Keep your eye on the prize as we're thinking about loss.
There's similarly a risk, too, if we were to say no, right, and not fund any of this, there is a certain population that would look at it and say, see, we didn't need an override, you fixed the problem.
Yep.
No. So you're not, either way, we're in the same position, and we need an override for more than just this item anyway, but this item, for it, against it, either way, will be used by half the people to support and half the people to go against.
Yeah, the town might say, look, they went back and sharpened their pencil. That's what we're asking everyone in the town to do, both sides of the game, to sharpen the pencil, and they
pretty sharp pencils.
They did, right. That happened.
This is really quick. Bob, you just said you didn't want to put words in the school committee's mouth. You were exactly right, and I just want to make that clear. We were clear from the beginning that however we manage this 438, it is 1 year only. Assuming there's another override, I think the stakes are enormously high for it, we're going to have to live with the results of that override. And this is not, we solved this, we solved it for 1 year only, clearly just 1 year. So you were dead right when you said that.
Okay, Colin Barron, just one second, just to reiterate Bob's point. So if I'm hearing this correctly, what we might do is suggest that the budget line go up to 41,401,651. Or 661, whatever the right number is.
661.
And not a higher number. Right. That it stays at that. And that basically means that the base does not go up except by that 100K. Right? So the other 150K is not reflective of a base going forward. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to follow up on what Bob said. And I was actually going to save these comments to the end after you had voted the budget. But everyone around the table talked about this is a one time only. You know, we need an override. I was going to suggest that we have the superintendent here, we have the town manager here, we have FinCom, the selectmen, and the school committee in session. I was going to make a suggestion that after you vote the budget, that maybe we spend 10 or 15 minutes talking about A, how to present that to town meeting on the floor, and B, how do we move forward to this FY19? We have everybody in the room, and maybe we need to start fleshing out what the next step forward is on that. So just a suggestion, I didn't want to impose on your meeting, but we have everybody here, and everybody agrees that, you know, this is a one-year deal, even assume that it passes town meeting. Then people are going to want to know what's next. I'd like to be able to give them what's next.
Yeah, at least start the discussion. Yep, absolutely. But first, let's take care of the...
No, I understood, but... I don't want everybody to leave, though. That's
Yeah, please don't leave. Other comments, either the board or others in the room?
41.
So FinCom, what I would suggest we do is look at the possibility of an amendment to line U99, possibly two, but certainly one. And then have, if we're going to have a couple, we can debate back and forth which, you know, we think may be appropriate, have some discussion, and then vote it. Does seem like a reasonable approach?
Yeah.
You want to bring the first one?
I will propose an amendment then to line U99 to change the amount to 41,401,661.
Second. You have a second?
Second.
Great. Any other numbers that want to be brought forward? No? Okay. Anne, anything from your side?
Nothing from my side.
Okay. All right, so now we have a motion for amending U99 to 41,401,661. Any discussion on the board? Not hearing. All right, we will do our roll call. Paul?
Support.
Mark?
Support.
Peter?
Support.
Eric?
Support.
Vanessa?
Support.
Paula?
Support.
David?
Support.
Anne?
Support.
Mark, support. We are 900. So now it's 41,401,661.
661.
Now we
get
that
10.
One of us was
passionate
funds. Please, yeah, I think anybody would probably be willing to put up the 10 bucks.
Take a collection.
Okay, there was a question about J91.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I applaud the restraint that the FinCom has shown tonight in handing out free cash on this issue. I was prepared to ask for some to be handed out on behalf of our public safety officers as you've gone to a higher figure. However, given the restraint you've shown, I will restrain my desires to increase that budget and I'll withdraw that.
Thanks for your faith.
Any other comment on that line? No? Okay. Are we ready in that case to go through the budget in total? The only change would be U99 is now 41,401,661, which would make the total, let's do this correctly.
It doesn't really matter, you don't vote the total, you vote the line items.
Yeah, okay, all right, you guys will update from that.
Yep.
Okay, so let's take the total. Let's go around. Paul.
Wait.
So this is now.
Not the total. Yeah. Now we're collectively vote. Right. We need a motion to vote.
If you want to do the enterprise funds, just move to support the line items as amended, B99 to Y99.
Yes,
as shown.
Yep.
So make that motion, please.
All right. Move to support the.
So moved.
Yeah. So moved.
Do we have a second? Okay. Now voting on this one. Paul.
Support.
Mark.
Support.
Peter.
Support.
Eric.
Support.
Vanessa.
Support.
Paula.
Support.
David.
Support.
Anne.
Support.
Mark. Support. 900. That's W through Y. Okay, and now we look at B99 through U99. Is that right, Bob? We need a motion on that.
No, you've done it.
No, that was B99.
Oh, sorry,
I was
just talking. Sorry.
Y99.
Mark, as chair, do you want to present this one?
Yes, I do want
to present this one. Sort of boxed in.
Okay. So to Barry's point, you do have all the parties here. One of the things, Bob will make his presentation, I'll make a presentation in front of town meeting obviously also, but one of the things that I think is paramount that we express to the town is that the options that exist are to have continually declining services or to vote for some form of an override. There's not a status quo, there's not a stay as it is. That's off the table. Expenses rise faster than we have revenues, so services are going to have to be cut unless we have a way to bring in new revenue, which is an override. So to Barry's point, one of the things that I think we need to think about, and again, the selectmen bring overrides, but what I think we hopefully can do is together talk about what it is that we can do and how we can do it. From my perspective, it's imperative it happens now. April feels like it's a long way away to me, but that may be the decision to do it. But we need to figure out a way whereby we can explain to town meeting what's going on with this budget, get their support, in order to explain to the town what's going on, get their support going forward. Barry, do you have any
questions? I have a question.
Sure.
So I'm trying to understand what you just said. So is this a discussion now to be able to properly communicate the town meeting on April 24th? Or is this a discussion that you want to enter into at 9:15 tonight about an override that the selectmen have to work out because it's their job? Which is it we're doing?
So I think part of the presentation to town meeting must include some information of how we move forward.
Well, you know, first of all, it's fairly clear, I think, and you've stated it very succinctly. The FinCom members, many of them have commented on their opinion that there's a need for an override in order to be able to go forward and maintain services. Not just here, in with the school discussion that's going on, but in the town discussion as well. Clearly, several members of the school committee have expressed that same interest. So, you know, I don't think that it's any secret that if your expenses rise and your revenues don't keep up, there's only one way to solve the problem, short of robbing lots of banks, and that is to go to the voters for an increase in the revenue base, you know, their taxes. So, you know, I mean, that I think is fairly clear and has been stated tonight by kind of everybody except the ones that actually have to put it on the ballot. Now, I don't think there's any question. You know, I think Barry's talked about it. We've all talked about the fact that there really is ultimately one solution, and that solution is more revenue. Only place you can get that is from the tax base. Voters are very clear that in what they told us, and what they told us was, do what we are, what I see everybody doing. Go back, live within your means to the best of your ability, and then prove to us that you've done that. And I think this is the collaborative effort that's going on. I think that's exactly what's happening. So I think the idea of positioning a discussion, a unified discussion, to town meeting is a very appropriate discussion for tonight, to try to engage at 9:15 in the override strategy is a bit of a stretch, because I actually don't think we can quite get there.
Strategy, yeah. You know, what I was just going to simply lay out there is figuring out the way in which we're going to get to that way. Maybe it involves working groups between the selectmen and the school committee. Maybe, you know, to begin to make a commitment that we're going to begin those discussions really right after town meeting, and how they come out, I think is an appropriate path forward for sustainability and what town meeting would expect. And, you know, at least the commitment from all the boards and bodies here, who all basically will ultimately be working on it, although it is the selectmen that ultimately call it after consultation with
everyone. That's kind of what happened the last time.
That we're just going to basically, you know, say, okay, like Belichick said, we're on to Cincinnati, we're on to 19, and here's how we're going to do it. And, you know.
Yes, I think we're in general agreement. What we need to do is present to town meeting this budget, but in the context of here's where we are, here are the options that go forward. We have a budget to present for this year. This is what it's going to look like, and here's how it's going to happen. If things are the same in fiscal 19, there are dramatic cuts that will continue, and things are very difficult.
Well, in the absence of expansion as well, which are things that, you know, almost haven't been discussed. I mean, you know, for example, we know that we're down 4 police officers from where we should be. We know that we're down probably 4 firefighters. And we also know that, you know, which has been aptly pointed out tonight, that if, you know, next year comes
and the revenue stream doesn't change, the thing that has been so worked on so desperately to save will not be savable.
Right.
So, you know, I mean, the idea of, you know, having a collaborative strategy, I think, that's where you're going there. I think that's part of what we tried to do last time. We didn't do it effectively. So,
but also, you know, starting it early, starting it right down.
Mr. Chairman, yeah. One of the things I think that we're not talking about here is really getting the pulse of the community, and I suggested a focus group environment where we invite people from all segments of the community to participate and really pick their brains about what did you support the override, what did you not support, why did you vote yes, and why did you vote no. We don't know those answers because we haven't interviewed those folks yet. That's an important step before we can formulate any plan, and I would urge this group to consider that approach, and I'm happy to facilitate
that. Well, to Dan's point, wouldn't you agree that, you know, the people in this room certainly have to participate, but I think he's really right on
this. Yeah, I'm wrong.
I mean, we don't decide. I mean, the voters decide. It's always their choice, so we got to really enfranchise them to be part of the grander discussion as we go forward. I mean, it's always their decision. So, I mean, you're not finding anybody at odds with each other in here about the fact that we need to proceed along a different path than the one we've been on.
Yeah, we don't have any metal chairs in the room. I don't want any Jerry Springer stuff.
And just, you know, so we're all clear, too, we're not attempting to reach way down the road now. But I think to Barry's point, and John's point, to Dan's point, it is a discussion that needs to start soon. Town meeting does need to understand the scenario themselves, and it is
10.9
communication venue, frankly, for the town.
Positions, so not teachers. Positions.
192 plus or minus that will attend, or minus and plus. Won't be pluses on that. You know, plus people watching on TV, and then it does need to get started. And then, and those meetings will last. They won't start at 9:15. They'll last a long time. But that's a good thing, and I think, you know, Dan has an interesting thought on that too. I think there are plenty of other ideas. There'll be some folks who want to chat as well. Madeline.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to Barry's point here. I think one of the most important things, and we have to think about what we will be able to say at town meeting, one of the most important things is to begin to execute the process to allow the community and all of us the time to work on disseminating the information about the override. We've shown in the past, if you go back to 2003, you need enough time to get people engaged and on the ground. And so you have to have the date and the amount out there early enough to do that. And I think that was, we did learn that that was one of the issues that impacted us among a few others. So I think that's one of the important things that we need to do. If we're going to collect information, we really are going to need to put a lot of effort into getting that done so that we can keep the process moving forward. And I'm quite sure that the school committee, hopefully under Ms. Borowski's, can I finish? That the school committee will undergo a very rigorous process as we did previously to evaluate, you know, what that need looks like. You know, I mean, we have significant cuts, have had significant cuts of positions already, so
one of the things I want to grab on Barry's point especially, it is the spirit of cooperation and the groups working together that I think has helped us with a temporary solution, which is great, and it's going to carry us forward. And I think you'll find from the FinCom a lot of ready, willing, able people to assist. Same thing from the school committee and others in the community that all need to band together. That part we're not going to resolve tonight. What we do need to be clear on is being very clear with town meeting about what has happened here, so it's clear that it is only this one-time solution. It's not a solution, it's a one-time activity. And that things need to change going forward unless the town is willing to accept continually declining services. And from what I hear, that's not what they want. I love the idea of hearing it.
No, I was thinking about, I was scribbling my comment to my chair.
You might have been passing notes.
Not
in the chair.
I love that we're all on the same page and how, as leaders in our community, we've been working together asking the hard questions. And I think that it is true that going forward, we have to work together. One of the benefits of all being in the same room is that we can each, instead of saying the assumption that we're all on board, maybe we can actually individually say that we're on board. And then, like you've been doing with a roll call vote with Ann on the phone, each of our committees can, we're not on the assumption that we're on the same page. We can say to town meeting, they see it on TV now, that we are dedicated to this going forward, each of us individually, on each of our committees. You know, when we do a motion, we vote on it. So I guess I'm suggesting for the school committee that we would vote to go ahead with the planning for an override. Our commitment is to go for this override.
I'm going to have a listening session to the community before we do that.
I'll certainly let other members of the committee weigh in on this, but that does fall to the purview of the Board of Selectmen.
Yes.
So for the school committee to take a vote to move forward planning an override, to me, seems like stepping in their sandbox a little bit. And I would add to the community, if you read the school committee chair's message and school budget,
yes,
it explicitly states that this budget is prepared and was expressly voted unbalanced with the expectation that there would be an attempt for a future override. That is the only way the budget we voted makes sense. So I feel like that message from the school committee has been made in a very public way.
I did not mean to play in the wrong sandbox. I was talking about recommending, because I do know that it is not our sandbox.
It was always on.
A lot of us have that issue, I think. Go ahead, Gary.
I just want to emphasize what Dan said, and I've advocated quite a bit. We don't really know exactly why it was a failed override attempt. And what Dan said, I think, is critical that we find out through focus groups, you know, what was the reasoning behind it? You know, did we ask for too much? Did they not have faith in any, you know, whatever, government board, town manager? But we have to find, and it's
all of us on the
critical to, like, go forward with some information. Because if we don't, it's like, you know, ready.
Yeah, I think it's a great
fire,
idea.
Fire, aim, I guess. Is that the old saying?
Yeah.
I happen to know some professional.
That happens.
No, and I fully agree with that, but we just don't want to get analysis paralysis where we don't give any advocacy group not enough time. So it's going to be a balance, and I just think we have to be really sensitive to that, because a lot of people really impacted their lives fighting really hard for something they believed in, and I think we should give ample time.
Good. Vanessa?
I think there's something to be said for the focus group concept. I agree with Paula about not getting bogged down in that. I think one of the things that we struggled with the previous override is that when we had these financial forums over the summer, there was no dollar amount. And so we were really talking in abstracts, and it's really hard to sell some, or to not, I don't want to say sell. It is really hard to advocate for an override when you don't have a concrete number to work with, because you cannot justify it. And I felt like that's what we were doing until we finally had a concrete number, and then we had such a short amount of time to bring people in and to inform them. I think a financial forum would be much more effective with a number in hand. Say, this is what we are advocating for, this is why we believe it. And as leaders of the community, one of the things I've heard is that the leaders of the community weren't front and center. I don't know if I necessarily agree with that, but if that is the feeling of some residents, then that's something we should consider as well, that if we're not quite there.
One thing we could think about, again, just starting the process, is that before you have a number, you really want to understand what you're working on and why. We understand some of the priorities and what some people are in need of. Most importantly, that really can inform the number and can then it works back and forth in terms of justification. So that may be another thought in terms of how to do it. The only caveat I'd give you to that is in some earlier financial forum several years ago, we put on the board and said, what services do you want? What services do you need? What services are you willing to cut? And the list of what you want, what you need, and even what you use was pretty tremendous. And the list of what you want to cut, I don't remember anything being on that list.
It's 16 meetings that there wasn't one service that was offered to be cut by the attending people.
So that
not one.
One guy said, don't pave my street.
Yeah.
Probably because it was just paved last year.
That was definitely not
one. But I think in terms of thinking and listening and having strong discussions backed by what people are saying, other than just the people that are in the room or they're watching on TV right now, has huge benefits. It's a huge opportunity.
Mr. Chairman, so to your point, I do understand the abstract nature of the way that went down the road last year. I mean, in some ways it almost had to. But I think that fortifies the suggestion Dan is making, because what we have heard loud and clear, I mean, there were 4,000 people that said no. Okay? I mean, it wasn't like there was a couple of people. It was an overwhelming, you know, 4,100 was counting.
And 10.
But my point is that what we're hearing is that there's a certain disparity in why people said no. And we're hearing more and more of it, and I think we need to engage that, because that may help in understanding what types of things would fit into an override that might have some, you know, measure of success. You know, so for as an example, one of the things that I've heard a lot recently is, tell me what you're going to spend it on. I mean, honestly, that's kind of an overriding, you know, message that I have heard. I've talked to a lot of, trust me, I've talked to a lot of people in the last 6 weeks, particularly. But, you know, beyond that, I mean, really, that's a conversation that goes on really from the time a vote is taken. And then, you know, when the vote is over, then people will start to talk about why they voted in a certain way. And so we've been hearing this, you know, really, and I'm sure you have too, since October, about what it was that was on their mind. One of the things that's a recurring theme that I hear is, I want to know what you're spending it on. I mean, I want to know how you're saving money, and we're showing them that. And I want to know what you're, if you want more of my money, tell me what you're going to spend it on. And, you know, I have brought this up several times over the course of the budget season. And I do think that the focus groups will probably bear out what I'm saying. I mean, I've heard enough of it. So.
And what has been your response in terms of what are we spending it on, and what has been the response?
Well, I mean, the response, I mean, in a general way, I mean, the response is we have public safety issues, we have foreign language issues in the school, we have curriculum issues in general. But, you know, when I say to them, if you got a police officer and that costs $75,000, and then there's accommodated costs that go along with that, and then there's also benefit costs that go along with that, and we know that in general, and I'm going to use a rough number, that a police officer creates $75,000 of expense, and that we typically spend about $2 for every dollar, $2 in the schools for every dollar we spend. And I know I'm not exactly right on that percentage, but I think it's close. It's kind of a two-thirds, one-third. Am I fairly close on that?
More like 60-40.
Okay. So my point to you, though, is that so if that spawns $150,000 on the school side, and that buys you two teachers, so and then you look downstream and understand that costs the average taxpayer $62. Now, if you say to a taxpayer, for $62 you get a cop and two teachers, they go, oh, that's something I can think about. I mean, it almost, you really have to take it out of the abstract. When we start talking about millions of dollars, people glaze over. It's hard to connect that until they see the one, until they see that their tax bill is going to be $1,139. Now that one they get, and they're trying to figure out what the cost benefit is there. So I think, based on what I've heard in the last 4 or 5 or 6 months, that we need to be thinking along the lines of,
what are we really asking for? People are not unreasonable in this town.
No, that was always the point. I was just in general, because not having a chance to hear what the feedbacks are sometimes, because there's always people who have the perception that they may not think, hey, not being familiar with what everyone's doing and how, you know, from a governance perspective, there may be a perception that we may not be doing a good job, right? And for that reason, people may just say no.
It's almost a standard response. I mean, it's government.
Well, yeah, so that's why I'm wondering when people ask you, when you tell them, what's the response back? Do they buy into it, or they say, well, you know what, I don't need that extra policeman.
Can I make a suggestion? I think this is a great, big, wide-open discussion that we need to have when we have the time and can dig into it. So I don't mean to cut it off, but I do mean to cut it off, because I think we can't do it right now. Eric, go ahead.
I was just getting warmed up.
That's why I wanted to catch it.
So
late night.
I also fully agree and embrace what Mr. Ensminger was suggesting about the focus groups. I think that small groups are effective. I think conversation is always better than debate, or worse. And I was at a meet and greet last night for a candidate for a school committee, where somebody there mentioned, somebody else in attendance said, boy, if I just would have had a forum like this, small, sitting in a circle, 15 people, to talk about the override, I would have understood so much more and been so much more engaged in all that. So I think there's definitely something there. So I'm wondering, is there room at the town meeting, and I don't know who it would come from Mark or from the Board of Selectmen, or some combination, for a message that goes something like this, and you've articulated some of it already. Here's the FY18 budget. It's a lot of this is, there's risk here. Really explain how we got there and all of that. But drive home the point that, you know, this is not sustainable. The only way out of this, as many people have said, to maintain the services that we have is an override. But we acknowledge that it was resoundingly voted down at the last time it was on the ballot. And so in an effort to reconcile those two, realizing that the only way to maintain these services is an override, but realizing the result of the vote, we, Board of Selectmen, School Committee, Finance Committee, whoever else, kind of resolved to really bridge that gap and understand why, to help us figure out the way forward. And so as a part of that, we would like to start these small forums and groups and focus groups and whatever, and maybe even put a date out there. We'd love to start them in May, in June, to really get ahead of this, because if we are going to go down that path, we do need time.
Yep.
Is there room for a message, something like that, during the town meeting, and you know, who could deliver that?
We always have the clickers too. Take some polls.
Yeah, I think that's good, but I think Eric's idea and piggybacking on yours is much broader than that. It's we've got the less than 192 people in that room. That's great. But it's the broader community that it's so hard to hear from.
Absolutely.
And your idea of trying to tap into that, and the flip side of that is maybe using that as a forum to reach people once some thoughts are together.
And that whole spectrum did not show up at the listening sessions last year. I think
right.
There was a limited spectrum that did come.
Right.
There were those that did not.
Yeah.
And we need to get them all.
To broaden. But yeah, I think we ought to think about who and how we might do that in a session.
Building off of this, what I would love to see, especially since we have all these people in the room, and not necessarily that we should hammer this out now, but if this is something that we are all on the same page about, some kind of a timeline that gives everybody who wants to be involved in this process time to get involved. If we want to have X number of, not financial forums, but these override meet and greets, where we say, okay, we hold X number a month. Getting into some of those nitty-grittier details to keep the process moving. If we know that it takes, that 6 months isn't enough, that we need to start 9 months or a year in advance, now's the time. And it seems like everybody's on the same page, and we have all these great ideas. We need a calendar, and we need people to commit to the concrete ideas to move forward. And perhaps that's something that we could put forward to town meeting. I don't know if that's too ambitious.
Real quick, sorry, Ned, just to build on now's the time. Last year at this time, I think a member of the public made this point at the recent Board of Selectmen meeting. We were having these discussions. The Board of Selectmen was, and others were talking about it, and we haven't started yet this year.
Which leads me to another question. If we were to put forward another override, in order for it to affect 2019, correct me if I'm wrong, but that would need to be voted in the fall?
Not necessarily.
It could be April?
Yeah, it could be before June 30th.
Yes. Yeah. But it might require you preparing two budgets.
So similar to what happened this past year?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let me just stop for a second. Bob, thank you for pointing out. Anne, so you have any commentary you'd like to add?
Yes, we'd have to do two budgets.
You're on mute. Or you're not with us.
I am on mute.
There you go.
I will be very excited and happy to participate in some kind of smaller listening and conversation setting. But I think that would be an exciting opportunity and maybe an opportunity to communicate and listen in a different fashion.
Super. So I think the question on the table is, how do we get started, right?
Mr. Chairman. So, just once again, if you label these the override discussion, you are immediately going to, I mean, I would suggest that you label it financial sustainability for Reading.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really what we're talking about.
You sound like a candidate for something.
really are about financial sustainability. Because if you pick one side or the other to name it, you immediately start to, create a divide that we're trying to avoid. I do believe that most people in this town want to get it right. They just want to get it right. Their idea of right sometimes is based on either incorrect information or inadequate information. And so, the idea of having financial sustainability discussions for our town puts everybody at a round table instead of at odds. And I just think that's a good way to think about it going forward. And, to Eric's point, there is a state of the town opportunity. I mean, there is opportunity in this town meeting to say some things. And so that opportunity will present itself, we'll get there on April 24th. I know that's done by the Board of Selectmen. And income. So, you've got this perfect opportunity where you're not trying to wedge something into an article or try to get the moderator to accept, a general conversation. I mean, boom, there's a spot right in this town meeting for the chair of the FinCom and the chair of the Board of Selectmen to talk about this. And the school committee. Isn't that right?
We just did school in the fall.
Oh, that's right. November. It's in the fall.
But as always, we'll participate anyway. That is helpful to your board.
So I do think that there's a way to launch a discussion. I mean, that's really what you want to do. Yeah. That's what's going to get people talking is a discussion.
Maybe one of the things we could do at the next board. I'm offering an idea. Sorry, I'm not projecting it, but is to think about whether it's committee of interested people, what's the right format for that? And as you said, not on a labeled, it's for the override basis.
Yeah.
It's for a discussion basis.
Yeah.
But how to get it started, who should be participating. Bob and I had an interesting discussion this morning about government, non-government. A lot of this, to make it happen, has to be non-government, right? The taxpayers, we're going to have to get really organized in terms of advocating. that's how it's going to happen or not. But I think we need to help for the starting point.
Ad hoc financial sustainability committee, for lack of a...
Formally or informally, but formed and you know, some town officials get involved, some non-town officials get involved. But I think we burned it pretty hard here. any last comments? We good? No? Can I entertain a motion?
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second. All those in favor? Oh, sorry, we have to do a roll call. I'm sorry.
We're out.
You guys are done. Paul, Dan, stay with us for a sec.
Of course, we can.
Paul.
Yeah, we can.
Hang up.
Support.
Mark.
Adjourn.
Adjourn. Adjourn. Eric.
Yes.
Vanessa.
Yes.
Paula.
Yes. Thank you.
David. Ann.
Thank you.
Mark, yes, we're adjourned. Thank you very much, everybody.